Yeah. Amazing grace. This has Holy, holy, God. Backwards when you should be looking forward to the author and finisher. The words I have sent forth is sent for each and every one of you. You keep looking back, it's never going to be back the same way it was. You must look forward and keep striving forward, because my spirit moves forward. It does not move backwards, says the Lord.
You're the one who made the heavens. You're the one who shaped the earth. You're the one who formed my heart long before my birth. Yeah.
What do you want me to do? door.
Why? I would
be Cathy. We've been judges for a long time, and we're only the judges 9.
Thank you.
And
good.
Perfect. Okay.
It kind of reminds me of NCIS, CSI, and all of the daytime soaps all wound up into one. Because judges, the theme is everyone did what was right in their own eyes. And that makes a bit of a mess, doesn't it?
Amen.
That's just being polite. The repeated cycle, Israel worships idols, God allows the surrounding nations to oppress Israel. Israel goes, oh God, I'm sorry. And then God sends a deliverer, and after the deliverer dies, Israel worships idols, and here we go again, and here we go again, and here we go again. This is our last week with Gideon. You know, Gideon may have had problems with fear, and he may have had problems, as we saw last week, with trying to do it in his own strength and not asking God what to do. Don't we all do that? Mm-hmm. But yet, Gideon was also mentioned in Hebrews 11 in the Hall of Faith. That gives us encouragement, because we do not have to be perfect. Gideon wasn't perfect, but he obeyed God even when he was scared out of his mind, because let's face it, that was a really crazy battle plan. But God got the glory. And when we do things for him, in spite of how crazy it looks, God will get the glory. So, as I said, we like our heroes of faith to be perfect, but no one but Jesus fits that bill. And there was a time when we saw Gideon acting on his own. He also had many wives. That can be a bit of a problem, as we'll find out later with Solomon. Gave him 70 sons, and in a neighboring town, not in the same town, but in a neighboring town, he had a concubine, let's just name it as it is, a sex slave, who gave him a son named Abimelek. Would it be fair to say that there was just a little bit of a lust issue here? And this sin, which was left unchecked, caused problems for Gideon's family after he died. This is a really, really long chapter. Sorry, people, but it is. It's got a lot of those really interesting names that we kind of go A period, Z period, M period, because we're trying to pronounce them. 57 verses. So, you know, like we've done before, read like 6 to 10 verses and then let somebody else take over.
Abimelech, son of Jerubbaal, went to his mother's brothers in Shechem and said to them and to all his mother's clan, ask all the citizens of Shechem, which is better for you, to have all 70 of Jerubbaal's sons? That Jerubbaal would be Gideon, right?
Right.
Rule over you, or just one. Remember, I am your flesh and blood. When the brothers repeated all this to the citizens of Shechem, they were inclined to follow Abimelech, for they said, he is related to us. And they gave him 70 shekels of silver from the temple of Baal-Beris, and Abimelech used it to hire reckless scoundrels. Sounds like politics of today. Who became his followers. And he went to his father's home in Ophrah, and on one stone murdered his 70 brothers, the sons of Jerubbaal. But Jotham, the youngest son of Jerubbaal, escaped by hiding. Then all the citizens of Shechem and Beth Milo gathered beside the great tree at the Pillah in Shechem to crown Abimelech king.
When Jotham was told about this, he climbed up on the top of Mount Gerizim and shouted to them, Listen to me, citizens of Shechem, so that God may listen to you. One day, the trees went out to anoint a king for themselves. They said to the olive tree, "Be our king." But the olive tree answered, "Should I give up my oil, by which both gods and humans are honored, to hold sway over the trees?" Next, the tree said to the fig tree, "Come and be our king." But the fig tree replied, "Should I give up my fruit, so good and sweet, to hold sway over the trees?" Then the tree said to the vine, "Come and be our king." But the vine answered, "Should I give up my wine, which cheers both gods and humans, to hold sway over the trees?" Finally, all the trees said to the thorn bush, "Come and be our king." The thorn bush said to the trees, "If you really want to anoint me king over you, come and take refuge in my shade. But if not, then let fire come out of the thorn bush and consume the cedars of Lebanon. Have you acted honorably and in good faith by making Abimelek king?" Next. "Have you been fair to Jerubbaal and his family? Have you treated him as he deserves? Remember that my father fought for you and risked his life to rescue you from the hand of Midian." Anyone else? "But today you have revolted against my father's family. You have murdered his 70 sons on a single stone and have made Abimelech, the son of his female slave, king over the citizens of Shechem because he is related to you. So have you acted honorably and in good faith toward Jerubbaal and his family today? If you have, may Abimelech be your joy. And may you be his too. But if you have not, let fire come out from Abimelech and consume you, the citizens of Shechem and Beth Milo. And let fire come out from you, the citizens of Shechem and Beth Milo, and consume Abimelech." Then Jotham fled, escaping to Beer, and he lived there because he was afraid of his brother Abimelech. After Abimelech had governed Israel 3 years, God stirred up animosity between Abimelech and the citizens of Shechem so that they acted treacherously against Abimelech. God did this in order that the crime against Jerubbaal's 70 sons, the shedding of their blood, might be avenged on their brother Abimelech and on the citizens of Shechem who had helped him murder brothers. In opposition to him, these citizens of Shechem set men on the hilltops to ambush and rob everyone who passed by. And this was reported to Abimelech. Now Gaab, the son of Ebed, moved with his clan to Shechem, and his citizens put their confidence in him. After they had gone out into the fields and gathered the grapes and trodden them, they held a festival in the temple of their god. While they were eating and drinking, they cursed Abimelech. Then Gaal, son of Ebed, said, "Who is Abimelech? And why should we Shechemites be subject to him? Isn't he Jerubbaal's son? And isn't Zebul his duty? Serve the family of Hamor, Shechem's father. Why should we serve Abimelech? If only this people were under my command, then I would get rid of him. I would say to Abimelech, 'Call out your whole army.'"
When Zebul, the governor of the city, heard what Gaal, son of Ebed, said, he was very angry. Under cover, he sent messages to Abimelech, saying, "Gaal, son of Ebed, and his clan have come to Shechem in a stirring up the city against you. Now then, during the night, you and your men should come and lie in wait in the field. In the morning at sunrise, advance against the city when Gaal and his men come out against you. Seize the opportunity to attack them." So Abimelech and all his troops set out by night and took up concealed positions near Shechem in four companies. Now Gaal son of Ebed had gone out and was standing at the entrance of the city gate just as Abimelech and his troops came out from their hiding place. When Gaal saw them, he said to Zebul, "Look, people are coming down from the tops of the mountain." Zebul replied, "You mistake the shadows of the mountains for men." But Gaal spoke up again, "Look, people are coming down from the central hill."
And a company is coming from the direction of the diviner's tree. Then Zebul said to him, "Where is your big talk show now?" That show part isn't in there. "You who said, 'Who is Abimelech that we should be subject to him? Aren't these the men you ridiculed? Go out and fight them.' So Gaal led out the citizens of Shechem and fought Abimelech, and Abimelech chased him all the way to the entrance of the gate, and many were killed as they fled. Then Abimelech stayed in Aruma, and Zebul drove Gaal and his clan out of Shechem. And the next day, the people of Shechem went out to the fields. And this was reported to Abimelech. So he took his men, divided them into three companies, and set an ambush in the fields. When he saw the people coming out of the city, he rose up and attacked them. Abimelech and the companies with him rushed forward to a position at the entrance of the city gate, and the two companies attacked those in the fields and struck them down. And all that day, Abimelech pressed his attack against the city until he had captured it and killed all the people, killed its people. Then he destroyed the city and scattered salt over it. I guess that's so nothing will ever grow there again. Mm-hmm. On hearing this, the citizens in the tower of Shechem went into the stronghold of the temple of El-Berith. When Abimelech heard that they had assembled there, he and all his men went up to Mount Salem, and he took an axe and cut off some branches, which he lifted on his shoulder, and he ordered the men with him, "Quick, do what you have seen me do." And so they all cut branches and followed Abimelech. They piled them against the stronghold, and they set it on fire with the people inside. Oh, this is so nice. Wow. And so all the people in the tower of Shechem, and about 1,000 men and women also died. Next, Abimelech went to Thebes and besieged it and captured it. Inside the city, however, was a strong tower to which all the men and women, all the people of the city had fled. And they had locked themselves in and climbed up to the tower roof. And Abimelech went to the tower and attacked it. But as he approached the entrance of the tower to set it on fire, a woman dropped an upper millstone. I guess that's, I don't know if that's hit, that's the heavier one, but it's, yeah, on his head and cracked his skull. Hurriedly, he called to his armor bearer, "Draw your sword and kill me so that they can't say a woman killed me." So his servant ran him through and he died. When the Israelites saw that Abimelech was dead, they went home, and thus God repaid the wickedness that Abimelech had done to his father by murdering his 70 brothers, and God also made the people of Shechem pay for all their wickedness, and the curse of Jotham, son of Jerubbaal, came on them.
Wow. That was a long chapter.
Yeah.
But before we get into it, Paul, could you turn down these lights? Because I kind of feel like I'm being interrogated.
Wait a minute.
That's what I'm feeling like right now.
That's funny. You can hang around with it. Okay, sorry, I don't want to.
One more.
Don't want to mess up the
list. She said she should watch your CSI.
Thank you, yes. Now I can actually see people. So, why did Abimelech rebel against his family when in an honor-shame culture you did everything to not shame your family? Mm-hmm. You did everything to make your father proud of you, even after he's gone. Mm-hmm. Why did he rebel? Well, Gideon had many wives. We already said this. And 70 sons. We don't even know how many daughters. The wives had the benefits of living under the protection and care of Gideon. And then in another town was his sex slave, who didn't live in the same town, didn't really come under the protection of him. She was just good to him for one thing. Can you imagine the shame that she carried? Can you imagine how she felt as all these other wives get all these benefits and she lives way over here? The feeling of worthlessness for only being good to Gideon for, hey, I'm coming by tonight. The bitterness she carried. The Bible speaks of the problems of bitterness and what it can cause. Let's look at Hebrews 12:15.
See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many.
We think that our sin, no one sees it, no one's affected by it, just us. But this tells us that if we have bitterness, it grows its roots down deep, and it causes trouble, and it defiles many. Our children pick up on any bitter root we may have. Mm-hmm. We think we may be hiding it, but boy, I'll tell you, those kids know. Even the little ones, they know something's up. They may not be able to call it what it is, but they know something's wrong. Just like when I told you the story before, I was having a horrible morning, and my little brave four-year-old Andrew looked at me and said, "Mommy, have you had Bible time yet?" Yeah, they know. They know. It's interesting that Abimelek means my father is king. Gideon named him that, but Gideon didn't treat him like that. He didn't bring his child home to be part of his family, but yet he named him my father is king. So Abimelech goes to his uncles and all of his clan to cause a rebellion against his father's house. Again, in an honor shame culture, you do not do that. It brings shame on you as well as your family. But when bitterness and resentment grow, you don't think straight. You just don't think straight. The bitterness of Abimelech's mom had passed to Abimelech. Mm-hmm. Not only does he cause shame to the house of Gideon, he kills all his brothers. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of brothers. Except for Jotham. I've heard this since I was first saved. Sin can have a snowball effect on our lives. We think we're hiding it, but we're not. And it snowballs. It just keeps getting worse and worse and worse. And even for generations, let's look at the Arab nations and Israel. That started way back with Isaac and Ishmael.
Yes.
And it's still going. We have my ancestors, the pilgrims, who dug up burial grounds on Cape Cod, thinking God had provided corn for them. And to this day, there is still bitterness about the Wampanoag, the Nauset burial grounds being desecrated. One sin, and it can snowball. So, notice that, like I said, this is kind of like the daytime soaps. I just read this and I started shaking my head. The people of the town gave him 70 shekels of silver from the temple of the god in which they worshipped. That's like coming into the church and taking the money from the offering and giving it to worthless scoundrels, which is what he did. That's supposed to be okay, but that's what they did. They used the money that they gave to their own god, not that he could use it or anything, to hire reckless scoundrels who became his followers. Reckless scoundrels. I'm baffled. They followed reckless scoundrels. They knew they were reckless scoundrels, but they were following reckless scoundrels? Ye. Why?
Because they were like that.
Because they're reckless.
Yeah, because they're reckless. The name of the god, Baal Berith, means God of the Covenant, but it was the wrong covenant, people. This god was also known as Baal Zebub, the god of the flies, which was the god of Ephraim. People carried small idols of this god in the form of a fly in their pockets, and they would kiss it. Kind of like kissing up to your god, I guess. This is how far people in Israel had gone. But, you know, yes, Todd.
You know, it's so funny. Seems a lot like today, a lot of these churches, in the fall, a lot of these churches where they use church funds to hire certain people to do music and everything like that, and then they go party with the money. And it's a fall of a lot of churches that's happening like that right now. And it's so funny because everything that's happening in this Bible, everything that we've been talking about, preaching about, is modern day today.
Oh, yeah.
Just dressed up in a different way.
Yeah, it's not that.
And, you know, these are things that we should look into and know that if we see this right here, we need to stand against it. Don't compromise.
Yeah.
Or turn a blind eye towards it right there. Call it out what it is.
Yes.
Because if you don't, it's going to seep in and it's going to grow roots down into it.
Yeah.
And it's so funny when you said about roots, right? We was out in Priscilla's backyard, our backyard, and we were planting some trees in Priscilla's yard, right? In the garden. And this is how the Lord is so funny. He talks to me like, when I'm planting, the condition of my heart was kind of like upset because it's cold outside. My wife telling me to do this like this. And now I'm planting with bitterness in the ground. So the bitterness that I'm planting in the ground, what's going to grow out of that? Bitterness.
Just pray over it.
So I went to the bathroom. The Lord spoke to me, so I had to go back out. Put my hand in the soil and speak life back into it. And take back that bitterness that I was planting in. And so it can grow, so it can be fruitful and multiply. Because a lot of times when we do things and the condition of our hearts is in the wrong place,
amen,
nothing good comes from it.
Amen.
Nothing good.
Amen. Amen. True. And it reminded me of...
Then I had to apologize to my wife. Most
of all. Yeah, you did.
What about the plants?
I did that.
Good.
Didn't we, Melissa?
Yes.
The root of bitterness reminds me of a bittersweet vine. They don't call it that for nothing.
Oh, really?
Have you ever tried to dig one of those crazy things out?
Yeah.
And you just miss this tiny little rhizome, and the next year, I'm back, here I am. We can't miss that one little rhizome when God is shining the light on our hearts. We've got to get rid of it all. Sandy?
Oh.
Yeah, I liked how it said in the footnote, on 12, Hebrews, Proverbs 4, 26 and 27, make level paths for your feet and take only ways that are firm. Do not swerve to the right or the left. Keep your foot from evil.
Amen.
I mean, people can be doing evil and you may want to repay back, but we can't. We can only let the Lord do it and pray and stand our own place in Him.
Stop reading my notes.
Well, I'm going through this, that's why.
Deb?
We have to be very careful because oftentimes very pretty things have thorns that go with them. Namely bittersweet, namely roses. God made all things on this earth for good. But He also wants us to watch for the thorns because we're not living, in heaven yet. So we should be aware.
Amen. Amen. So we have the coronation. Abimelech's coronation takes place under the great tree by the pillar. Why that pillar is there may surprise you. Can we look at Joshua chapter 24, verses 25 and 26? This just freaked me out. This is what took place there a few hundred years previous.
On that day, Joshua made a covenant for the people, and there at Shechem he reaffirmed for them decrees and laws. And Joshua recorded these things in the book of the law of God. Then he took a large stone and set it up there under the oak near the holy place of the Lord.
The person that's so evil is being coronated as king in the very same place where Joshua made a covenant for the people and reaffirmed the decrees and the laws that God had gave them right on that very spot.
Oh,
yeah. Wow, indeed. I was like, oh, I think they forgot their history. But when you're not following God, but your own idea of what God wants to do and who you think God is, then things like this take place. And we've got to be careful in our own lives because sometimes we make God in our own image. Dare I say it?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
We make God in our own image. Oh, God would never. He is always love. Well, yes, but He's also the just judge, and He's also a God of wrath, though controlled. You know, it's not just like He blows up and goes wild. There's a purpose in it. There's a purpose in everything that He does. He's 100% love, 100%. And usually people tell me, oh, God, no, God is a God of grace. God is a God of love because I just said that really you shouldn't be doing this. Oh, but God will forgive me. Why, are you planning on doing it again? We've got to be careful. We've got to be careful. I went down the same road that the very same person who told me God is a God of love, God is a God of grace, therefore He'll excuse my sin again and again and again and again. I can't stand in judgment against that person because I was like that too. We have to be careful not to make God's our own idea of who God is. But God was not at all pleased with Abimelech, and neither was Jotham. And so Jotham goes up on Mount Gerizim to tell a parable of the trees. But before we get into the parable, let's look at Deuteronomy 27, verse 12, to find out what took place on that very same mountain several hundred years prior.
When you have crossed the Jordan, these tribes shall stand on Mount Gerizim to bless the people: Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Joseph, and Benjamin.
As the Israelites were going into the promised land, Mount Gerizim was the mountain of blessing, and these tribes were reading the blessings that God was going to give the obedient Israelites. And on the other mountain were the curses for those who disobeyed. And here is Jotham standing on the mountain of blessing, and he is coming against Abimelek. And he starts with, listen to me, people of Shechem, that God may listen to you. Because they were in sin. Mm-hmm. And they didn't want to admit it. While standing on the mountain of blessing, he's saying that. And he tells this parable of the worthy trees. They knew they had a job to do, and that did not include being king. But the thorn bush up in north of Boston, we call that a pricker bush. I don't know what you call it, the same thing here. The pricker bush represented Abimelek. And Jotham was a tad huge, sarcastic, when he said that the thorn bush said to take refuge in his shade. No, thank you. I avoid thorn bushes, thank you very much. In what shade, thanks. That sounds too painful for me, but that's the point he was trying to get across. So in short, Jotham curses the towns that follow Abimelek, and then he went and hid. So Abimelek rules for 3 more years. It seems like God is not going to do anything. It seems that Jotham's accusations that his stepbrother in the towns of acting dishonorably was wrong. Yeah, God's just not going to do anything about that. Nothing's going to happen with that. Things went along fine. And sometimes God tells us he's going to deal with certain situations in our lives when people have come up against us, and we want to take it into our own hands because we think that God is too slow. Yeah. Or that he doesn't hear, mm-hmm. or that he doesn't really understand this. I just love that one because I've done this. God, you just don't understand. Okay, let's back up. Yeah, he does. But his timetable is not our timetable. So 3 years, everything goes smoothly, but God was not pleased at all with what Abimelech did. So God, who says God stirred up animosity between Abimelech and the men of Shechem, and they, in essence, pulled a coup. In the end, the town of Shechem was destroyed, the people were killed, and Abimelech was killed by a woman. Here is a woman who uses what she has in her hand once again, you know. So why did God stir up this animosity? God did this in order that the crime against Jerubbaal's 70 sons, the shedding of their blood, might be avenged on Abimelech and on the citizens of Shechem who had helped him murder his brothers. We should never, ever take vengeance in any way, shape, or form. Amen. Oh, but God, I just had to say that. No, you didn't. On anyone. But bitterness can tempt us to do so. We need to make sure that our heart is right with God when we're wrong. Let's look at Proverbs 20:22.
Which one? Proverbs
20:22.
Do not say, I will pay you back for this wrong. Wait for the Lord, and he will avenge you.
Amen. It's God who deals with people. It's God who deals with people in his own time. Because it's not just about you. It's not just about me and we've been wrong. It's about the other people involved too. It's about, as we've said before, sin snowballs and it affects everybody. God knows the right time to fix things. So, I'm going to act like my husband tonight. And I'm going to say, what did God speak to you about in this study?
Don't hold on to bitterness.
Amen.
It's
Don't have 70 wives.
Amen, brother.
Let go and let God.
Amen. Deb?
The throes of war and sometimes many years of abuse. And we think that God doesn't care. And thousands of lives are gone. But to God, he knows exactly what's going on. We're all in the palm of his hand. He will not only avenge us, but he will bring us all to the fruition that the great judge would be. And we should believe that no matter how horrible Hitler, we can think of Hitler and many, many, many horrible things in the world. And these very same things that will cause secular people to turn their face away from God. The reason they don't know that is because they really don't know who God is.
Amen.
And we should tell them.
Amen.
Don't pay evil for evil, for the Lord will do it. And he could be building us up in the spirit realm to be able to stand against those things later in our lives.
There was a couple of towers in that. And bitterness leads up to, it's like you're going in a circular staircase up the tower. Bitterness leads to anger. Anger leads to want for revenge. Revenge leads to thoughts of murder. Murder leads to other things. And before you know it, you're dead.
Yeah.
You know, and it's one bondage opens to another bondage, opens to another bondage. And instead, the Lord has asked us to forgive. You know, blessed are those who forgive. We need to be able to forgive those who have harmed us. It's hard, but he asks us to forgive. He asks us to allow him to be judge and not us. For we don't know what maybe that person was going through that day, and the plans that God might have for that person to change their lives later. He doesn't want us to be the people who put the stumbling block before them. We just need to put things in his hands and let him deal, judge wise, righteously.
And it was one sin, the sin of lust, that set this whole thing in motion.
Yeah.
The whole thing. So we need to keep short accounts with God. When he reveals something we need to repent of, we need to repent right away. Because otherwise, if we keep hold of it, it's going to snowball. And one of the ways that you can know that you've really overcome the bitterness and have forgiven is when God says to you, why don't you witness to that person about me? And if you're like, okay, God, I'll do that, then yeah, you've gotten over it. But if you start going, that hurt, really?
What?
Oh, okay, you need some more prayer. You need some more prayer.
Thing I like about this, you can forgive, but you ain't got to forget.
It's true.
And you ain't got to let that hold you hostage either. It's like a stepping stone in the learning process right there, so it doesn't happen again.
That's right.
And whenever possible, live at peace. And if you can't live at peace, you keep it moving. Mm-hmm. And don't let that take any root in you. That's why you keep it moving.
Yes. That's it.
You know what I mean? I can love you, but I can love you from afar because us Christians are peculiar people. And we love each other, but we don't have to agree with each other all the time. You know? And that's the thing where we have to walk in love like that. Yeah, you're my brother, and we can disagree to disagree, right? And we can agree to agree. And sometimes it be like that. We can just come to a common ground. Okay, well, this is not going to get settled. So let's move on and go somewhere
else. Well, it's
like
supernatural,
you know what I mean?
Love. It's not,
instead
we're not,
of stuck right there,
yeah.
And anytime you see each other, you be like, yeah, I got that against you. It's not good.
But that's the neat thing about agape
love.
Yeah. Agape love says, we can agree to disagree. That's happened with me with a few people. We can agree to disagree, and then you both agree not to bring that up again. Because you love that person in the Lord so much that you don't want to harm the relationship. And is it worth harming the relationship by, I'm right and you're wrong? Is it? No. God will take care of whoever is right and whoever is wrong eventually. So love one another. Deb.
I love that scripture. In as much as is possible, live peaceably with all men. So God does understand that sometimes these things are not possible. But he asks us to. It's beautiful because he loves us through our humanness and teaches us how to love our enemy whenever possible. And in as much as is possible. And many things are possible with God, right?
Yeah.
Not just what's possible with us, but with God in us.
Wow. So we learned a lot about sin and how it can snowball and bitterness and a bitter root and how not to treat people. How our sin affects other people. Ouch. But in all this, God saw it. In all this, God took care of it in his way. And in all this, we have to just give it, like two people said already tonight, give it to God, let him handle it. Because they'll know we are Christians by our love. It's easier to live at peace with someone who isn't close to you. But when you're disagreeing with someone in the body of Christ or someone you love, it is really hard. But we have to let it go and give it to God. And God will work it out.
Yeah,
God will work it out because it just keeps coming over and over and over again. I read it this morning again. We need to set our minds on things above, things about eternity. If I push this, if I push my opinion with a brother or sister or with someone outside the church, how is that going to affect their eternity? Is it really worth pushing it? That's the type of thing we have to look at. I think we need to worship a little bit because that was kind of a hard study.
Just come before you tonight, we ask forgiveness for any time we have let bitterness take hold in our hearts and in our lives. We ask you, Lord God, to come in by your Holy Spirit and bring love and forgiveness to those areas in our thoughts, in our mind, that need that touch by you, and that the bitterness would be washed away in Jesus' name.
Amen. As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty. Like no other, your name
the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to say of your name.
Enjoyed.
What?
I hope you enjoyed.
Thank you.